Welcome to Cliburn Masterpiece. I'm Buddy Bray. I'm your host for this series, and we come to you from the Kimball Art Museum in Fort Worth, Texas. Cliburn Masterpiece is a series in which we delve into masterworks written for solo piano. We also get the perspectives of our Cliburn laureates and some special guests as well. In this episode of Cliburn Masterpiece, we'll look at Pictures at an Exhibition, an 1874 solo piano suite by the Russian composer Modest Mussorgsky. We'll get the perspective of 2017 bronze medalist Daniel Hsu, and also the perspective of a noted symphony conductor. That'll be Andrew Litton, the music director of the New York City Ballet and the conductor laureate of the Bergen Philharmonic. Our conversation with Andrew Litton and Daniel Hsu is coming right up. Why do you think audiences are still so attracted to pictures at an exhibition?
I think it's because no matter how much we love to listen to music, we're still a very visual species. And to have a picture, basically a piece that depicts pictures, even though some of them don't even exist anymore, some of these works have disappeared, the music itself is so descriptive and evocative that I think it captures our imagination. And the other great thing about pictures is it comes in basically 10 short sections. So, you know, it's almost like short sound bites, which I think, especially in our current culture, is definitely appealing.
I've always been interested in like sort of these larger character programmatic type works that kind of are very explicit and kind of tell a story from beginning to end and involve a lot of different characters. So I was playing Fantasy Stücke by Schumann, and I was thinking about the next sort of character work that I wanted to learn, and pictures came up. And I, of course, was probably more familiar with the orchestral version as many, many people are. And the more I listened to the piano version, the more I realized like what a great piece it was. And that was kind of what got me started on the pictures train.
What's different about playing character pieces? You mentioned the Schumann Fantasy Stücke, Pictures at an Exhibition, Concrete Examples. What's different in your process about playing those than something that's just called sonata?
That's a good question. For me, I think of sonatas generally more as a whole in one chunk. I think in character pieces, there's definitely more in-depth, you know, thinking of colors and characters for specific parts of the piece than in sonatas. And I think in sonatas, there's a bit more thinking in terms of the story from beginning to end, right? Like, how do these three movements relate to each other? They're pretty similar, but slightly different, I would say.
Do you think of it as a totality, as a 30 minute from point A to Z, or do you think of it as 10 short bites?
That's a really good question. I think of both things, actually, because of course, if you walk into a museum and you start walking and looking at the paintings, there is a certain cumulative experience from having attended that exhibition or that art gallery. But again, each painting is its own world, and each little piece that Mussorgsky writes us is its own world.
Do you think that certain of these pictures tell stories? Are there story arcs within the pictures themselves, or do you just think of them actually as still photographs or still paintings?
I think of them as still photographs, basically, or still paintings, because what he does is spend his energy, Mussorgsky spends his energy, I think, giving us the emotion of the painting and the colors, and if you will, the way the paintings are constructed, rather than well, that day in the Tuileries, this kid did that to that kid. You know, I mean, I'm sorry, I'm obsessed with Tuileries. It's my one of my two favorite movements. I love it. That and the chickens.
It definitely varies for me. I don't think it's more one way or the other. But I would say it's for me, it's leaned more towards the picture and using music to describe the picture for me than it is like a specific story. Although I have thought of it as a story, you know, of the troubadour and, you know, the specifics, you know, maybe the troubadour, this is the observing the troubadour over time, him telling the same story to multiple people, slightly differently, slightly exaggerated, you know, like it's come in both ways for me, but I would say typically it's more towards the picture side.
Why do you think composers, orchestrators have been so attracted to the work? It wasn't just Ravel. It's been a lot of other people as well who've made their own versions of it. What do you think is the draw? What is the allure?
I think because the piece is so colorful, one of the reasons why, well, the fundamental reason why I chose to become a conductor is when I was attending the young people's concerts that Leonard Bernstein was conducting it when I was 10 years old. I couldn't believe the colors and the sounds an orchestra could make, even though I'd been playing piano since the age of 5. So for me, piano became a means to an end to become a conductor and to be able to control all those gorgeous sounds and colors. And I think people listening to the Mussorgsky original hear that's trying to come out of a piano, but it takes really a great magic sorcerer on the piano to truly capture all the colors that are actually possible in the piece, which as soon as you apply, in most cases it's been set to a very large orchestra, as soon as you apply all those parameters, the piece just takes off as a colorful showpiece. And in the case of Ravel, it's just a perfect, I think, pretty darn perfect realization.
There are so many possibilities. There are so many characters. There are so many colors. And of course, the piano is the best instrument. There's no question there. But I also want to note that there's a sort of pattern amongst pianists who also add their own flavor, their own ornamentation in the work. Very famously, Horowitz had a really, really like great version of this. So, I mean, I think it's just because this piece is so vivid and imaginative and invokes both the interpreter's imagination and the listener's imagination. So it seems like a natural fit.
We do, in music, tend to think of Mussorgsky as one of those very talented, but not particularly 100% schooled composers. What is it in his music that makes him, to some, feel like a talented primitive or a talented amateur or something like that?
Because he was really a perfect Russian composer in that he created sound worlds and textures and harmonies that others around him were far too conservative to think of. For example, Tchaikovsky, you know, and Tchaikovsky, of course, far more popular composer, but Mussorgsky was far more innovative in a way with his exploration of music, the way he wrote. And so, you know, maybe more cutting edge, maybe he influenced more people than he actually inspired people himself.
I wonder also if, since Mussorgsky was never a professional composer, whatever that might have meant in his time and place, maybe he felt less constricted by certain rules or norms that might have been in place. You talked about Tchaikovsky being too conservative to try certain things. Tchaikovsky might have felt a little hemmed in by what was right and proper. Right. To do in the professional world of music. And Mussorgsky and his crew, Borodin, Rimsky, and those guys maybe felt a little more freedom to experiment since they made their living in another way.
I think that's a really good way of putting it, Buddy. I think that pretty much summarizes my understanding of the whole situation. And certainly the musical results speak to that completely, I think.
Mussorgsky and Rimsky-Korsakov, even Alexander Borodin, 3 of the Russian 5, did not make their living primarily from composition. Mussorgsky was a civil servant. Borodin was a doctor, Rimsky-Korsakov had a brilliant career in the Russian Navy. Having two interests, two passions, is something you know a little bit about yourself.
Right. Yeah, I always find that part of the history of the three of the five being really, really interesting. I've always been interested in computers and technology, and have been writing software since I was pretty young, like maybe 13 or 14. It's really interesting doing both because I think they both require a lot of the same sort of creativity and like problem solving and thinking. There's a lot of structure in both industries. During this time, it's been interesting to think about how technology can help bring music to people during this time. For me, music is a great comfort. There have been a few moments in my life where like I've been really, really sad or broken about something. And in those moments, music has been the thing that kind of carried me out of it. So I think for a lot of people who are, you know, struggling during this time, music is their comfort. But without, you know, accessibility to it now during COVID, I think, you know, technology is the way to help accelerate that or to help bring music to more people. So having a hand in both at this time is really interesting to explore those areas.
As the conductor standing on a podium, can you do what's on the page and the character springs to life, or do you have to help it?
You don't really have to help it very much. It's beautifully orchestrated. The colors that Ravel gives us are very much based, you know, he wrote pretty darn well for the piano himself. So I think he really understood what Mussorgsky was doing and therefore gives us, with his incredible orchestral palette that he had his whole life, just a really perfect depiction. You know, we were talking about the chickens. This really fast staccato woodwind writing back when in 1922 was probably awful. It probably really sounded like a fox got into the chicken coop, you know, but now, of course, you hear it and it's perfect, you know, but it's just so adorable the way he does it. I'm happy to be looking at the score now. And it's, of course, lots of high woodwinds. And then we get to some of the other movements, like, for example, the Bidlo, which is set so low, and you have all these really low bass instruments depicting the ox cart. You know, it's it's fantastic. Of course, you can do that on a keyboard, but to actually have all these different colors and sonorities that Ravel uses very, very happily, I think it's unsurpassed. It's fantastic. Mm-hmm. And in Tuileries, he gives us all these this playfulness that I think is so much fun to bring out. You know, he writes capriccioso, which makes me always think of a pizza. But anyway, there's this lovely, the Dio, you know, it's almost like mama, you know, as the kids are playing in the playground. And then suddenly this subito romantic, which he sets for the violins. And then of course on the piano, it's just dee da 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 dee da da da. And of course the great pianists really make that work, but just to suddenly give it to soft violins like Ravel does, it's a totally different world instantly. So I think so much of what Ravel does is really just bring it further to life, if that's possible. Nothing could take away from the fact that somebody thought of these notes in the first place, and that somebody was Mussorgsky.
I want to talk about, you know, just some specific instances within pictures, I mean, where the music itself might need a little interpretive help. And then in other movements of pictures, maybe playing music itself is enough. For instance, Gnome, the very first picture, which needs to sound there need to be some surprises in it. It sounds a little bit erratic in some ways.
The first picture is kind of startling, coming off the promenade, which is very, very, it has like a sense of nobility, a little bit of sadness, but it's sort of like in that genre of music, and then suddenly you have like you're plunged into this character music, right? And there is a lot of context on the page about, I think there's a lot of context on the page about the effect that Mussorgsky wants from the music. So the beginning of the promenade is, so sort of like walking, march-like, as it has this character of nobility, and as you go, and it's marked in the score a taka to go straight into the next variation. So before the audience has even, you know, finished registering, you know, oh, this is the great introduction or the great prelude, you're straight into. Instant fortissimo to piano change, and then another sudden fortissimo, which is like fortissimo, fortando, 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 rest. So like very like rest of the fermata, right? And it's like extremely indicative of like, you know, Mussorgsky wanting this sort of dramatic and like, you know, it's October at the time of filming this, so it's like, you know, a little bit of Halloween spooky, you know, that's, I don't know, Halloween existed back then, but you know what I mean? Like, it was a very dramatic movement.
Can we move on to Il Vecchio Castello? That's another whole challenge, the old castle, the second picture. It seems to me, or it did 100 years ago when I played it myself, that the challenge inherent in the old castle was that it is repetitive.
After sort of like the noble opening and the crazy gnomus, this is sort of a more quiet, more like scenic sort of work, I would describe it as. There are challenges. It is quite repetitive. The left hand's in this constant like, and it sits throughout the whole piece, and the theme comes back multiple times. I think there are a lot of the things that really bring color to this picture in my mind are the way that Mussorgsky uses textures and the way that he layers the music. So the initial melody is single line with expression. Like a left hand question and answer or conversation type thing. But as the piece develops, he adds more notes, more textures, while sort of retaining the same feeling, like. Texture thickens. There's even more to unpack, and there's more possibilities.
Daniel, if we can skip around just a little bit and talk about the ox cart, which is, it's like the old castle in a couple of ways. One is the two are both in G sharp minor, and the other is that there is repetition sort of inherent in both pictures.
I started to think of it as like, you know, the ox car sets off in the distance, right? Like, that's why the repetition is still there. That's why it's still there. It's just getting softer and softer and softer because this terrifying, scary thing is like slowly moving out of your vision. And, you know, it's in the context of pictures, it's like you're engulfed. Imagine like you're a viewer at the gallery and you're looking at the picture and it's like depicting this thing. But as you begin to walk away from it, you know, as you distance yourself, the ox cart is moving away in its distance, but it's still retaining its character. It's still this menacing, you know, sound. And as you walk away to the next picture, you know, it still retains that. So that's how I've begun to think about it.
So Daniel, if we could, I'd like to talk about the marketplace at Limoges, which has a reputation. It has a certain notoriety amongst pianists. It's very difficult to play.
Yeah, so this is definitely the picture, like one of a couple of pictures when you have this piece in your active like performing set, this is like one of the things that you're really, really worried about. There are two things that make it difficult. One is it's not the same repetition over and over again. It's like a couple notes here, a couple notes here, like one note here, and then you repeat it, and then they're just kind of difficult patterns. And two, they have to be light. Like you can't have a really, really heavy gossip at the marketplace is not, you know, we're not ox, it's not oxes at the marketplace. It's, you know, it's a light, it's loud, but it's light. It can't be really heavy and like bogged down. So these things make it like just a pain to learn, to maintain, to perform. It's just, it's a doozy. The notes, the way I thought about it was like this stuff, not the easiest thing because you're starting on one side of the hand, you're kind of shifting to the other and then coming back and then like having a light repetition. So I consider this like the high intensity stuff, like the difficult stuff. So if I needed to be a bit, like, obviously I want to be as relaxed as possible, but if I use a little bit more energy or a little bit more force here, then that was okay because it's like a little bit harder. And then I would use these repeated notes in the second measure, where it's kind of like eight notes of the same as like the relaxed point, right? Like if you use a little bit of that, you lose a little bit more energy in the first measure. The second measure is for you to cool off and just kind of like repeat as light as you can without using too much energy. And then, so like, this is a little bit higher energy. And then this is relaxed again.
Aside from the pianistic challenges in pictures at an exhibition, there is all this connective tissue, in a way. These promenades, he calls them, which are, of course, analogous to someone in a museum or a gallery walking.
For me, they're definitely connective tissue. I think it kind of sets the piece in certain ways and kind of divides the piece in certain ways. And also, later in the piece, it's pretty important, right? There's the transition between Catacomb and Baba Yaga, where there's this kind of eerie side movement that has the theme of the promenade. And I think the reason why that is because many of the pictures begin and end with a little bit of the context of the previous one, right? It's kind of reminiscent of, you know, somebody walking away from the picture. So I think the context of being the person in the gallery is extremely important in this piece.
Was it a new piece for you when you came to the Cliburn?
It was not a new piece for me when I brought it to the Cliburn, but it was a piece that I had sort of learned and then put on rest and kind of like forgotten about it and brought it back for the Cliburn. And for pieces like pictures, it's especially interesting and valuable to do that because every re-entrant to like exposing yourself to the piece, or like every relearning of the piece changes your perspective on it so much, just because there are so many characters and colors and themes throughout the piece. I can't remember for this thing specifically, but I remember like the whole of pictures was, you know, from learning it to the first performance was maybe 3 or 4 months. And, but of course, you never really quite ever master anything. Everything's always a work in progress.
Our thanks to Daniel Hsu for talking to us today about his experience with Mussorgsky's pictures at an exhibition. Here he is performing the Mussorgsky Pictures in the 2017 edition of the Van Cliburn International Piano Competition. This is from the quarterfinal round. Here's Daniel.
Thank you. Thank you.
a captivating performance from the 2017 edition of the Van Cliburn International Piano Competition. That was Daniel Hsu performing Mussorgsky's 1874 solo piano suite, Pictures at an Exhibition. That's all for this episode of Cliburn Masterpiece. Thanks so much for watching.